So hi, I'm Craig Rowland, founder and CEO of Sandfly Security. Today, we're here with Rob Joyce. Rob Joyce is former head of the Tailored Access Operations Group of the NSA, among other jobs and titles he held. He has a lot of experience in the InfoSec and cybersecurity, having served his country for multiple decades now, I guess, through the NSA. And now he's here today to talk to us about Linux security threats and nation state operations against Linux infrastructure and critical infrastructure in particular. So welcome, Rob, to the interview today. I was wondering if we could just kind of start off, give us I didn't do your background service, frankly, you know, way more than I can get into. Can you tell us a little bit more about your background and what you've done?
Sure, Craig. And it's great to be here talking with you today. So I spent 34 years at NSA, came there straight out of college and did a variety of roles, starting with, you know, an engineering job all the way up through leadership. But along the way, had some awesome jobs. You mentioned tailored access operations and computer network operations. Those are the hackers of NSA. So they go out to produce foreign intelligence for some of the most important priorities of the nation. There was also other jobs along the way, like I did national policy down at the White House as the cybersecurity coordinator down at the White House, and even did the acting Homeland Security Advisor role for a while in that job. I finished up here in March as the Director of Cybersecurity, where in that job, we protect all of the classified networks, the military networks, and the weapons platforms. So all the things that are the most important things for the U.S. government to protect, up to and including the nuclear secrets, we're responsible for. So between those two kind of bookend jobs of the go out and hack networks and then defend the most targeted networks, you get a different view on how you secure things and what it means to be secure. So, you know, I'm really a believer in the it takes a thief to catch a thief, because your mindset changes working in those different environments. But definitely a cool run, but I needed to build back some sleep debt over the years. And now on the outside looking in.
Yeah, I can imagine. Anyone who's been in InfoSec, it's definitely one of these industries with a high burnout rate if you're not careful. Although 34 years is quite a good run. So, you know, good on you for that. And it sounds like you've done a lot of really interesting work there. So, I mean, so you came out of the NSA, obviously you worked blue and red team sides. In particular, we're probably more interested in the red team side today, or the attack side that we're seeing from nation state, even private actors to a degree. What's kind of the equivalent of the TAO, you know, that Russia, China, and other adversaries are running, and how would you rate their operational effectiveness compared to what, you know, obviously not compared to the NSA, but in terms of how do you rate them? You know, who are these people and how do you rate them in those terms?
Yeah, there's four major programs that we worry about in the West, right? It's Russia, China, Iran, and North Korea. And, you know, I'll start with China. China certainly has the most hackers on the planet, right? They just have sheer mass. And, you know, a decade ago, people would look at them and think they're noisy and not very responsive, not very capable. They would do pretty obvious things in breaking in and trying to exploit machines. But over time, we've learned, one, they've gotten better. And two, of course, you see the least capable hackers out of the Chinese arsenal. And the more sophisticated things are actually pretty capable. So, you know, there's two elements in most of these countries where there's an intel service that is doing operations, and there's a military service that has grown up to do operations as well. Both are usually collecting intelligence. Both are usually trying to do some sort of effects or influence as well. And in the case of the Chinese, they run the gamut across intelligence collection. But most recently, you know, going back about a year, we started talking about this intrusion set called Volt Typhoon. Volt Typhoon is a military effort that is preparing for eventual conflict with the West. And we see them going after military networks and the things that would allow the US and allies to support a conflict in their theater. But they're also going after critical infrastructure these days. There was a set of public testimony by the director of NSA, director FBI, director of CISA, and the Office of the National Cyber Director, where they testified to Congress talking about this intrusion and the targeting of critical infrastructure. But what made it special was they're prepared to disrupt this infrastructure with the intent of inducing societal panic. And by that, I mean, you know, they want people afraid. They aren't looking to stop tanks and ships and airplanes from rolling. They're actually looking at water and power and pipelines and things that will cause panic inside our country for the outcome to get us to turn inward at times of crisis. And so that, you know, in another way of phrasing it, that's terrorism, right? They want to panic society. And those groups have gotten pretty sophisticated. And the types of things they're doing is they're burrowing into networks and using living off the land techniques. So they're not bringing malware. They're coming with credentials, either stolen or getting into networks and creating legitimate accounts that they can then go back in and use the tools and capabilities that are resident inside those networks themselves. And that's really hard to detect. So Craig, one of the reasons it's so hard is, you know, because they're not doing espionage, you're not seeing gigabytes of data coming out of the network all the time. And so they, you lose one of the signal indicators that you're compromised. You know, they only have to go in, they have to spend some time understanding the network, and then they just have to revisit enough to understand that they still have access and control and that they can do the things they need to do. So that makes it a really, really hard challenge.
Yeah, we've seen and heard similar cases where perhaps we found some malware or signs of intrusion on systems that wasn't being used, right? But it was probably left there just as just in case, right? Like you said, it come back later and they could do what they need to do. And it's interesting that you're saying that they're more doing it to cause trouble here domestically, because I mean, to your point, you know, if they could cause mass unrest here and military needs to respond to internal operations or, you know, logistics or food or things of that type, civil unrest, that it would be obviously you're less effective. Or even, you know, you're on, you know, a carrier task force and you're worried about what's happening to your family back home, right?
Absolutely. And the politicians too, right? It gets hard to spend resources going to the other side of the globe when you have trouble at home. So
yeah, that's right. Yeah,
interesting tactic. So, you know, there still is tremendous amounts of intrusions against commercial entities by some of these Chinese groups looking for everything from intelligence to commercial gain. But they're an aggressive group. The other thing we're seeing out of this activity is they're using a lot of Soho routers and small Linux devices and things that are internet facing and always on. So some are DVRs, some are webcams, some are small devices that are IoT enabled, and they're unmanaged and unprotected. And often, you know, turn out to be a great pivot point for operations. So they can come through a couple stops overseas. They can hit these devices on a network, and then they can pivot back out of that device and now use that local IP that's inside the U.S. and touch a victim from, you know, what looks to be a high reputational IP address. So these small Linux devices are being co-opted into botnets that become the infrastructure for further, much more important hacks. And we're seeing that pretty regularly. So I think, you know, understanding how we protect these small devices is really key is a really key operational need. And I think that's one of the things I was excited about Sandfly doing, is you can actually help protect some of those devices that maybe aren't powerful enough to take a full EDR solution.
Yeah, we've had some customers have contacted us because they found command and control servers running on their Synology devices, among others. Others have contacted us to see if we could check routers and VPNs because these are major choke points for the data. I mean, you know, as an attacker, you know, why, you know, you would want to attack the choke points, because the data is hit there. It's unencrypted before it goes to the VPN, right? So why not just go where all the data is concentrating anyways? It takes it all. So it's interesting. So we talked a bit about them using and building these networks. They're basically building their own Tor network, but using publicly facing routers, often probably in the US. So again, you can't block, geo-block these, because you know you're not going to block Comcast, right? You know, or that type of thing. So that makes total sense that they would do it this way. And you've also discussed too that they're doing a lot of living off the LAN techniques, which I think is interesting, because I think a lot of people get in their heads that advanced attackers are always going to be doing this really customized implants and stuff like this. And one thing I always bring up is that you lose all plausible deniability, right? So if you're doing living off the LAN techniques, those could be done by anyone, right? So doing attribution is extremely difficult because someone ran a netcat command on the box, right? Or something like that, right? Whereas, you know, a custom implant, you're like, yeah, you know, this took a bit of sophistication to pull off. And not just that, but a lot of times the custom stuff will be very fragile. And I suspect, getting to your point, if you want to have operational things in play that you can use in the future, you don't want them to be fragile. You want them to be there when you return to actually use the things. And it seems like custom implants and stuff, especially on Linux, people worry about loadable kernel modules and stuff. And it sounds cool. It sounds very Tom Clancy. And I'm not saying it's not a threat, but you know, the first time you upgrade that system, that type of stuff just breaks immediately. And it also, a lot of times they reveal themselves by basically crashing the box, right? So it's one of these things where, you know, I don't know, I've never been government red team, but if I did, I think my first priority for my team would be saying, try to be living off the land and don't rock the boat. Right. So, I mean, to your point, right? Yeah, don't pull over gigabytes of data. You don't need to. We just need to have an account there with admin access when we want to switch off the water.
Yep, exactly. So, Craig, you and I have had other conversations. One time you told me about your little black ninjas costumes. I think that's a great analogy. You want to give that here?
Yeah, I have a video. I have a video about it on YouTube. So, yeah, it's called Ninja on Rooftops. And the way I explain it is, like, you know, if you got some elite hiding mechanism, elite rootkit or whatever, it's like if you were running around, you wanted to break into houses, and someone says, hey, you got to dress up in all black like a ninja and go running on these rooftops. And that works cool, and you're hard to see, up until the point the first person sees you. Then at that point, the fact that you're dressed all in black running around the neighborhood is like, gets everyone's attention. They all know you're up to no good. And that's what it is with a lot of these advanced attacks and rootkits and stuff like that, which is, it works great up until the point that someone sees you're there. Then at that point, it's very, very obvious you're up to no good, right? So if we see a process on Linux that is deliberately trying to hide itself, Linux is the premier open source operating system in the world. So open is the operative word. So there's nothing on Linux that's trying to hide. So the minute we see you, and this is something we do extensively, is we look for people deliberately trying to hide. At that point, you're not a nun, right? I mean, if we know, we know you're up to trouble. So the question is, what kind of trouble are you up to? So this is a tactic that we actually advise security teams to do, is we say hiding is an indicator of compromise, right? It just by itself, just hiding flat out, you should be paying attention to that type of stuff. So, you know, a lot of people want to focus on finding specific malware signatures. I advise, look for hiding or people trying to hide their tracks. It could be as simple as, you know, are they tampering with a log file? Well, that's a hiding, right? So, you know, that type of stuff is all very, very valid. It's just as valid as doing a big you know, known malware scan. In fact, it'll often find more problems. So to your point, but it's interesting too. So, you know, beyond the operational targets that we see in critical infrastructure, what are some of the other reasons you see Linux being targeted and kind of how do you think, why do you think Linux is being targeted by the nation states, even beyond just pure like shutting off the water? Are there other things you see about it?
Yeah, there's a lot of reasons these attackers go after Linux. One of them is the fact that Linux is often on these always on devices, right? It's hard to hack something that's turned off. And so if you intend to be able to go back at will to either get data or move through a device, you really want it on. So that's one aspect is Linux devices are often persistent and just always there. The other thing is...
And unupdated a lot of times. Like, they go years and years without being updated.
Absolutely. Another reason, Linux devices are used is because they don't traditionally either have security features, or if it's something like a video camera or your NAS, how often do you expect somebody's checking the logs on those devices, right? Are there even logs on those devices? So they're they're a dark corner of the room that you can actually sit on and be outside the scrutiny and focus. The Linux boxes provide a host of tools, and they usually have connectivity. So they make for this great place. And even if they don't have the information you want right there, they're just a perfect place to kind of lurk unnoticed. Even in an incident, you may go and clean up a lot of the rest of the network to include, where you've got a custom implant and other things. And it may be that you can live on that small unmanaged device. I would also offer that in many companies and many large networks, there's this layer of devices that are part of the unplanned, unmanaged infrastructure. And so there's tech debt in a lot of major networks where there's this shadow IT. It's either added and they didn't understand that, no kidding, that's a full Linux computer with all the operational software to be a server. It may be that, somebody's added that, and chances are that if it's been added and forgotten, it's not being patched, it's not being upgraded. So it's really important to understand and know the network, because I know that those adversaries are going to learn and know that network better than the people who administer it, right? You built a network and designed it as you wanted it. But in reality, the attackers are going to figure out how your network is configured as it exists. And by that, I mean, they're going to find the devices that are forgotten and not upgraded. They're going to find the devices that weren't part of the true, IT department's installs. They're going to find the flaws that are in that network and go ahead and exploit those things, because they've found those things that you haven't.
Sure. Yeah. This it's interesting you bring it up. So when I did red team stuff, these orphan systems, for lack of a better word, I started calling them internet crack houses, because they're just like the abandoned home that like the squatters move into, and then all of a sudden cars are getting broken into in your neighborhood, burglaries are happening, people getting mugged. I mean, it's just a recipe for disaster. And to your point, is exactly right. I could take a $30 Raspberry Pi and plug it into a network, and that is a full-on, I mean, it's basically a desktop Linux system for $30 that fits in your pockets, the size of a deck of cards, and you could cause a tremendous amount of trouble with one of those devices. So it doesn't take much. I think it was actually NASA several years ago got hacked because someone had a Raspberry Pi plugged in that's just being on watch. But
I know there's a famous example of one of the casinos, I think it was Caesars, that they had contracted for a major fish tank. And it came and it had IoT devices to control the water flow and the temperature and report out. And the company could check on that little device remotely. And so it drilled out of their network, but it was hosted inside their network. And it became the hot point for a whole intrusion. Again, because it really wasn't managed by the IT staff. And it became that point of presence. It became that crack house inside their casino.
Yeah, it's just, it just take one employee to plug something in and that's it. But we've even seen inside other networks as well. So it's very easy to spin up a VM, right? And it's very easy for that VM, hey, I'll spin it, it's temporary, right? Famous last words. And it's very easy to leave that thing there. And then not just leave it there, but people forget why it's there, or who started it, or what it's being used for. And it sometimes the systems, I've noticed, they develop sort of aura like, well, we don't know what that system's doing, right? But and then we've heard of other times of security teams where they had to investigate an incident and they just didn't have credentials to get onto boxes, right? So, you know, even the security teams can't get onto these systems. And as you're pointing out, right, if they're the origin of the problem and they don't know who's running the box, and it's amazing, even in large companies, how it gets out of control. Yeah. So kind of, I remember seeing you talk many years ago at Usenix, and I think you developed this reputation as like, you're really the first person to come out of NSA and open the kimono, for lack of a better term, to show like, this is how we operate and how other nation states are also targeting critical infrastructure. And I felt that was a really important talk because it allowed you to share with US and allies, you know, kind of, this is what we're doing. And if we're doing it, this is what everyone else is doing. And you gave some advice during that talk that I think is kind of evergreen in terms of what's going on. So can you go over a little bit? And I'll have a link to the talk down here, but if you could find it, it's Rob Joyce talking at Usenix. He goes into this. Can you get a bit about how that advice, how's any of it kind of changed over that time? And, yeah, you know, how do you think the industry has even improved much in this area or not? So, maybe they haven't improved.
Yeah. So I do think it is evergreen, right? It's the same as you would give for health, you know, eat your vegetables, don't smoke, get exercise, you know, 8 hours of sleep. In cybersecurity, there's a series of things which are, you know, you need to manage, you need to manage and know your network. That's the first thing. You know, you can't defend a network if you don't know your network. So, you know, I wasn't as explicit in that talk, but you've got to have some sort of deliberate program that is scanning to understand what devices are on your network and what their patch level is. So, you know, that's a bit of advancement in the way I talk about security. A second thing, I talked about passwords and, you know, the importance of passwords. Today, you know, I'd really extra hard foot stomp multi-factor authentication, right? You've got to have multi-factor authentication and ideally not SMS text message validation, because it's too easy to SIM swap a phone, and if it's important and protected that way. You know, first, great if you have multi-factor and at least do SMS, but ideally any of your critical assets, you really want to get onto either some sort of authenticator, some sort of you know, hardware second factor, but get beyond those factors. The third thing is, you know, patching. The internet, everything internet facing these days is scanned many, many times a day. And there's repositories out there like Shodan and others that keep track of what devices are on the internet, what their current patch version is. And so the day a new O-day drops and becomes an N-day, you know, you can watch the graph of exploitation happen, and it explodes as soon as there's a proof of concept out there. And so, you know, the attackers are going to come at your devices. So you've got to know when that new heinous thing drops, what you've got in your network, and figure out how you can mitigate those things, right? then, you know, for the big network owners and operators, you've got to turn on your logging. You've got to make sure that not only is it on, you're looking at it, doing something with that logging. Because in the end, you know, you can wear your black ninja suit, but in the end, you're doing things on those devices. And so, you know, logs at different places, and in different, in different aspects of your operations across your network, there's going to be anomalies in there. The other thing I didn't talk about, in that talk that I do believe in these days is, honeypots and tripwires. You know, the idea that you can come across and figure out, that something that shouldn't be happening is happening because somebody's bumped into it. So those are kind of some core things, but, you know, for a bunch of different reasons, there's new techniques and things that can help you that are not terribly hard to implement, right? Which is where I love some of the Sandfly things. The idea of a lot of these devices are not going to change in your network, right? If you've got a switch or a router and it's really a Linux appliance, if you've got a camera, a NAS, some sort of video DVR for your security, you know, those things are really not, again, they're not being actively managed. They shouldn't be actively changing. So, you know, the stuff you do with drift detection, to say, hey, it was this way for months and months and months, and now all of a sudden there's a change. Why is that? We ought to have somebody putting a focus on that and figuring out why. You know, that's an important thing. You know, I talked about passwords, but it really goes to credentials. How are you protecting your credentials? Where have they been left lying around in a network? Because that's one of the first things an attacker is going to do is they're going to go through that network to try to find credentials they can pick up, whether they're encrypted, that they can take offline and break and bring back in to have creds, or if you've, no kidding, left an SSH key accidentally on a server where you generated it and then, you know, put it in as into the authentication file, but then you never actually cleaned it off the system and you just left it lying around.
We have stories, believe me.
Yeah, that's the gift that keeps on giving. Yeah. So those are the kind of things I'm thinking about. But, you know, the reality is much of cybersecurity is paying attention to the details. And that's hard. It's really hard. So you need to find some technology that helps you pay attention to the details, because the adversaries are using that technology, right? I mentioned those scanners and things. And so you've got to have some capabilities that take care of some of this for you.
Yeah. One of the big things with our product is and the way we wrote it, the way we did use an agent list, so we're not tying into the kernel, is that we want massive visibility. So our product is just king on, we want to work everywhere. We don't want to leave anything unwatched, because again, our experience doing red team stuff is that's going to get you in big, big trouble, leaving an unmonitored system. It's just, I can't put emphasis on it enough. Even if you're not using our product, you got to get some way to watch these Linux systems, because you are going to get in trouble. And unfortunately in the InfoSec world, a lot of teams spend too much time on Windows, and I'm biased. I am a lifelong Linux user, right? But Linux is usually run in the critical infrastructure. You know, so people see Windows on their desktop or Mac and they think that's the internet, but that's not true. Like 90-95% of cloud workloads are Linux at this point. A lot of critical infrastructure is Linux. And you may just leave it unwatched, you're gonna run into trouble. You know, and if I was red team, I'd just be a Linux specialist. I mean, why am I gonna go on the Windows? The Windows endpoints will have a half dozen different antivirus products running on them. I mean, they're so heavily watched. You know, maybe I would target it in a phishing attack to get a jump point to get to a Linux box, but I would be trying to get to the Linux systems as quickly as possible. I'm not gonna be messing around on the Windows system. That's my personal approach. If I put my tinfoil, you know, red team hat back on again, is I'm going for the Linux systems myself. So it's just something we do run into a lot.
Yeah, you're spot on, Craig. I mean, you're going to go the path of least resistance, and you know, by definition, in a lot of these networks, it is absolutely the Linux devices. And you're also going to find that, you know, you can get to places that are unexpected. And yeah, I would argue absolutely that most of the unexpected places aren't Windows, right? They're Linux, and so many different flavors and types of Linux, and different types of processors and versions, and that makes it hard to have custom software on all those. So that's where I think, you know, you come in and do some incredible things.
Yeah, the way we explain is like, so Linux is an umbrella term. It means everything from a big GPU cluster up in the cloud down to the Raspberry Pi Zero that's the size of a postage stamp, right? So it's like when someone says, "Oh, we're going to protect Linux," pretty hard, right? You got to have a way to work across all those devices, because I guarantee you, as we already talked about, that Pi Zero is just as big a problem as that unwatched server. I promise you it is. So, it's got just as much potential there. So I appreciate your talk. Do you have any final thoughts or things you'd like to leave people with in terms of, you know, how they might want to be approaching the problem of better monitoring and visibility? I know we've gone over quite a few things today, but do you have any closing thoughts you'd like to add?
I think in the end, it's about the details, right? Figure out a way that you can continuously work the details, develop understanding, have something that continuously watches, and that you're asking questions about the state of your network and your devices, and that you've got some things that are going to help you with alerts and warnings with a reasonably high confidence factor, right? You can get worn out chasing warnings if the threshold is too low. But when you can develop certain flags on stuff that just shouldn't be happening, or if it is, you really need to go figure out why, that's an important capability to have.
So then, one more question that I'll leave you go, because you left a good point here. So this is one thing I advise people: customers, sometimes security teams, are very reluctant to disable things that are causing a lot of false positives. And I'm always like, you should do that, because you don't want to be flooded with noise. Is this something that, again, as a final comment, I mean, what would you leave to security teams that are really, would you say they should bias towards more noise or less? I probably know the answer, but I figure I'll leave it with you.
So in the end, it's biased toward less noise, but there are ways to not numb yourself. And that's where the tools and technology come in. Right. They should be providing some of that overwatch, and then you should get confidence in the things when they're alerting you that they need to be escalated and investigated.
Cool. All right. Well, Rob, I appreciate your time today. Hopefully everyone learned a few things here about how to better watch your networks, and a little bit better about how nation states might be approaching the problem of attacking your networks and things you can do to help improve it. So thank you again for joining us. I appreciate your time today.
Thanks, Greg. It's great talking to you. I appreciate it.
Great. Thank you.